Hey, as you're sitting down, say hey to somebody around you. Tell them good. You look beautiful. Well, hey, it's so great to be here with you this morning at Propel Church. I got to be honest, I'm so excited for this morning. You know, it felt like we hadn't had church since last year. And for some of you, you realize that we haven't. We ended up doing a Christmas Eve worship experience, and then we take the last Sunday of the year off to give our team a break because we believe that rest is not only biblical, but it's part of God's heart. And so we rested, and then we were excited to come back on January 8th, and then the snowpocalypse came through last week. And, you know, whenever they say it's going to snow in North Carolina, you never know whether or not to believe the weatherman because he's lied to us so many times. But he didn't lie this time, and, I mean, it was on there thick. Tori's got a video, but it was funny. I watched our dog try and roll in the snow, and he's sliding on ice, and he just wasn't worried. I mean, so snow happened last week, so we had to cancel services, but we did Snowpel 2017. It was an online worship experience where you and your family still got to hear God's word, and you got to worship with us, and it was amazing. And I'm excited that this week we get to kick off a new series called This Is Living. See, years ago, I had a drug addiction, and I thought my life was going okay. I thought everything was working out. I thought that I was smooth sailing. And then I began a relationship with Jesus. He changed my life forever, and I can confidently say, hey, this is living. I thought I knew what life really was. I thought I knew what life looked like, but no. This, a relationship with God, is living. And so I want to talk with you a little bit about it. God laid this message on my heart almost a month ago, and so I'm ready to get it the heck out. Like, I've been waiting with anticipation. But I'm going to need your help this morning to teach God's word. One of the things I want to do, I want us to have a culture. So some of you have gone to churches before where you couldn't respond, or I call it the church of the chosen frozen, right? They don't say anything. They just sit still the whole time. We believe that you ought to be responsive to God's word. So I want you to turn to your neighbor real quick and say amen. Turn to your other neighbor and say, preach. All right, feel free to do that at any point during the message. And some of you don't have a church background, so you don't know, man, why do we say amen? Why do we respond to God's word? There's something that happens. When you say amen, it means one or two things. It's either standing in agreement with God's word, or it's saying, Lord, let it be. Let it be in my life. I know my circumstances might not say it. I know my situation looks a little bit rough right now, but God, would you let it be in my life? I believe that you can do something that only you can do, and we're going to see God move this morning. Amen? So what I want to do, if you got a Bible, we'll go to Luke chapter 5 this morning. I'm reading out of the New Living Translation, and if you don't have a Bible, we say this every week at Propel Church, hey, we'd love to give you one. And so if you walk out to the information booth at the end of our worship experience, you can get a Bible free of charge. I had a conversation with a guy the other day who said, hey, Pastor, don't you know, I know we give out Bibles every week. Don't you think we ought to give out some less expensive Bibles? Don't you think that we ought to just give some cheap Bibles if we're going to give them out for free? And my response was, man, I'm so glad that God wasn't cheap when he gave his life for us. Amen. So we're going to give out expensive Bibles. We believe you ought to have access to God's word. I don't want you to have a Bible that sits at your house that you never pick up because you don't understand it. I want you to be able to read God's word. And so we'd love to give you a free gift, free of charge. This is our way of saying, man, we're excited for the journey that you're on. Luke chapter 5, it's a story of Jesus having a conversation with some disciples. Here it goes. One day, as Jesus was preaching on the shore of the Sea of Galilee, great crowds were pressed in on him to listen to the word of God. And he noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for fishermen had left them there and were washing their nets. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus asked Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. So he sat in the boat and he taught large crowds from there. I love the fact that when the word of God is preached, great crowds draw in. Oftentimes you'll hear that if a lot of people start showing up, then it might not be of God. And most of the time I just think it's jealousy in churches that people aren't showing up. But when the word of God is preached, people show up. Jesus was the most excellent communicator that had ever walked the face of this earth. And when he starts delivering God's word, so many people come that he can't just stand on the shore and teach them. He's got to get into the boat so he can get out into the middle of the lake so that he can teach to a whole slew of people. It was this exciting moment. And they're in the middle of the water, and this is what it says. It says, when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon Peter, "Now, go out where it's deeper and let down your nets to catch some fish." "Master," Simon replied, "we worked hard all last night and didn't catch a thing. But if you say so, I'll let down the nets again." And this time their nets were so full of fish that they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners in the other boat. And soon both boats were filled with fish and on the verge of sinking. And when Simon Peter realized what had happened, he fell to his knees before Jesus and said, "Oh Lord, please leave me. I'm too much of a sinner to be around you." For he was awestruck by the number of fish that they had caught, and as were the brothers and the people with him. His partners, James, John, the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. Jesus replied to him, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people." And as soon as they landed, they left everything and followed him. I've called this message the best year ever. I want to help you today say bye to 2016 and say yes to all that God has for you in 2017. For some of you, 2016 was a rough year. It was very difficult. It was very frustrating. You thought God was going to do things that he didn't do. You expected to receive things that never came in. And 2016 was a year of great disappointment. But I want to teach you through the reading of this passage today how to have the best year ever. Will you join me in prayer? Jesus, thank you for your word, your grace, and your truth. And today, God, as we open it, as we dive in, I pray that it would be revealed to us, that you would open our eyes, that we may see you at work in our lives. God, we trust that when your word goes out, you give us a promise that it doesn't return void. And so we thank you for every person in here that's going to hear this message, whether in-house or online, and they're going to know, God, that you are the one who saves. Give us grace, give us truth, and teach us your ways. In Jesus' name. And the whole church said, amen. I want to pull back up verse number 2 for you. I love what it says in verse 2. It says this, that he noticed two empty boats at the water's edge, for the fishermen had left them there, and they were washing their nets. Now, the first time I read it, I'm a literal person. If you've known me for a long time, I'm a very literal person, very analytical person at times. And so when I read washing their nets, I'm thinking, why did these guys get some soap and some water and sit there, you know, with some Dawn, like, you know, the stuff that can get oil off of ducks, right? They're going to wash their nets. Why aren't they doing that? And so I went to the smartest person I know. I said, "Hey, Google," and, you know, opened up my phone, and I'm having this conversation about washing nets. Several other passages of scripture will refer to the people washing nets, and what it would translate to is that they are repairing or cleaning out their nets. See, a part of fishing that happens when you cast nets out is you begin to catch debris. Your net begins to get full of other things, things that don't help you actually catch fish, like shells and whatever else is on the bottom of oceans and lakes and stuff. And I thought, what a fitting illustration of life, that as we are doing life, sometimes our nets get filled with debris. They just get filled with stuff. They get cluttered and filled up. And so if you want to have the best year ever, here's the first thing you got to do. You got to clean out your nets. I'm fully convinced, I got a big fishing net here. I'm fully convinced that some of us come to God with our fishing net. And we say, God, I want you to bless me. I want you to give me a promotion. God, I want greater influence for you and your kingdom. God, I want you to help my family financially. God, I want you, hey, your brother needs a car, right? And don't forget about me down here. You know what I mean? We come to God and we're saying, God, we need all these things. We need your grace. We need your love. We need your help. And we come to God with a full net. We come to God, life fills up this net, whether it's sports or work or job or family, life has filled up our nets. And I'm convinced that these men couldn't catch the amount of fish that God had them catching if they hadn't cleaned out their nets. It would have been filled with debris. I want to ask you, what is your net filled with that is preventing you from experiencing all that God has for you? Because our nets get filled so often. And so you come to God and you say, God, I want you to fill my net. I want you to fill my life. I want you to give me your grace and your love and your mercy. But you can only have part of my net because 3/4 of it's filled up. God, I want you to give me a promotion, but I haven't really made any room for you. See, in a relationship with God, subtraction will always equal addition. As God brings increase in your life, it will cause you to have to remove some other things. Turn to your neighbor and say, clean out. You guys did really bad at that. We'll try it again. Turn to your neighbor and say, clean out. You got to clean out your net. You've got to open it up so that you can receive all that God has for you. Because you cannot catch the blessings of God with a full net. And time again, I think you and I do this. We got to clean out our net. And you say, well, Pastor, what gets cleaned out? For some of you, it's relationships, right? Single lady or ladies, you got a boyfriend right now, and he's a loser, right? You need to clean out your net. Don't look at him. Just clean out. For some of you, you've got things that are in your life that aren't helping you accomplish what God's called you to. It's just filler. It's just stuff. It needs to be cleaned out so that you can grow in your relationship with Him. We're going to clean out our nets. And honestly, church, this is why we're in 21 days of prayer and fasting. Now, for some of you, sorry, it's going to drive me crazy. For some of you, you didn't know we were in 21 days of prayer and fasting because we haven't met, but we are. And prayer and fasting, we do it twice a year, super intentional, at the beginning of the year and in August. And we do that because we want to remove, we want to clean out things that are in our lives so that we can reconnect with God and invite Him to do what only He can do. Now, fasting, for some of you, you hear the word fasting, and you're thinking, look, I can't go without food, right? I mean, look at, you think I've been hungry? No. But fasting has so many forms, so many facets. My wife is doing a social media fast. For some of you, you know that social media is something that fills your net completely. And during the times where she's no longer on social media, she has the opportunity to connect with God in ways that she hasn't. What do you need to give up? What do you need to clean out so that you can grow in your relationship with God? So we're going to clean out our nets. Here's the second thing. We're going to push out. We're going to clean out. We're going to push out. Here's verse 3. Stepping into one of the boats, Jesus said to Simon, its owner, to push it out into the water. And so he sat in the boat and he taught the crowds from there. And when he had finished speaking, he said, now go out where it's deeper and let down your nets to catch some fish. He said, I'm going to push out. I'm going to go into deeper waters. Now, deeper waters is a really churchy term that people use to describe a growing relationship with God. If you've ever been into a pool before and you start at the shallow end, you're in 3 feet of water. As you go into deeper waters, you begin to realize that the level of the water is rising. And at some point, the water level rises above your head, above your ability to be in control of it. And it's like that with a relationship with God. You might start out in 3 feet of water, but God's desire was never for you to sit in 3 feet of water. It was to go into deeper waters, to walk into new things, to trust Him more and more and more. And what breaks my heart in the church more than anything else is people who claim to have followed Jesus for 40 years and should be in the deep end and are still in the kiddie pool. Who should have this cultivating relationship with God, and yet when you look at it, their relationship with God is contingent on whether or not they came to church on Sunday. God never intended for your relationship with Him to be just a Sunday experience. He doesn't want to just be your Sunday God. He wants to be your Monday God and your Tuesday God and your Wednesday God and your Thursday and your good week and your bad week and your I hate my boss week. Like, He wants to be your everything. He wants to be in your everyday life. And here's a gauge on whether or not your relationship with God is healthy, is if it's growing. How many of you have a garden, right? Only a couple of you. How many of you tried to have a garden and you killed it, right? Several of you. One of the things that we realize and we know is that healthy things grow. Healthy things grow. And if you have a healthy relationship with God, it should be growing. Now, one thing we also know about growing is that growing is sometimes painful. So just because I'm not telling you that it's going to be a cakewalk to grow in your relationship with God, because oftentimes it will require great sacrifice and will be difficult. But are you growing? That's the question. Is it healthy? He says, Peter, I want to push out. I want to go out into deeper waters. And then in verse 5, what I love is, and he says, I want you to let down your nets again. And Peter replies, Master, we worked hard all night last night, and we didn't catch a fish. In other words, he's looking at Jesus and saying, look, I know this is what you want me to do, but I got to be honest. You weren't the one out here doing the work last night. I already tried this, and it didn't work out. These men were professional fishermen. This was their occupation. This is what they did for a living. Could you imagine you not accomplishing what you set out to do at work, and somebody walk in, and they're like, man, I really think you should do it again. You're like, this is what I do, right? I got this covered. He had all the knowledge in the world, but God wanted to do something in his heart. And so he says, I want you to let down your nets again. And he looks at him in this moment and he says, but if you say so, I will. I want you to know, if you don't hear anything else that I say this morning, if you'll adopt that phrase into your life, your relationship with God will be changed forever. But if you say so, but if you say so. And you know the beautiful part of that is that you don't have to understand God to trust him. If you trust him, he says, God, I don't have all the answers. I don't even know why we're doing it again. Because it's the middle of the day. And in this time, fishermen didn't fish during the middle of the day. They fished at night. And so he's thinking to himself, yeah, it doesn't make sense that we would go fishing today. This is not the opportune time to do what you're asking me to do. I don't understand it. But you know what? If you say so, I trust you more than I trust this situation. I don't have to understand God to trust him when I know he's the one that's in control. And he says, but if you say so, I will. And immediately he lets down the nets, and the nets begin to fill up with fish. For some of you, you are terrified to go into deeper waters and step out again because it didn't work out for you the first time. And I want you to notice something that's so interesting. When these men did it on their own, they didn't catch a thing. But when Jesus was the one who was the initiator, when Jesus was the one who told them to do it, they received a blessing like never before. And if you're not the one in control of your life, and he is, then your problems are his problems, and he's got you taken care of. But if you say so, I will, because I trust you. I think one of the things that you have to ask yourself is whenever you're having a hard time stepping out in faith and going into deeper waters, growing with God, is do I actually trust you like I say I do? It's really easy to say, I trust you. But when it's put into practice, when it's tested, does my life indicate it? Here's the third thing. You got to seek out. So we're going to clean out. Turn to the person beside you and say, clean out. Turn to the other person and say, push out. Now we're going to seek out. I love it. You guys did it. I didn't even have to tell you. You're amazing. You're beautiful. I would buy you all lunch, but I'd be broke and I could never afford it. We'll pray for that. Free lunch in Jesus' name. Amen. That's right. Come on. Preach. We're going to seek out. You and I were never created to do life alone. In fact, what I love about this story is that what God was doing in Simon Peter's life and in Simon Peter's boat was not attainable by himself. It says that they sought out help from people from the other boat. And at this time, their nets were so full of fish, they began to tear. A shout for help brought their partners in the other boat. But soon, both boats were filled with fish and were on the verge of sinking. Now, if both boats were filled with fish and on the verge of sinking, what do you think would have happened to Simon Peter's if he would have tried to do it by himself? It would have gone down. It would have sunk. And you and I, when we try and do a relationship with God on our own, our boat will sink every single time. Because God didn't create you to do life alone. In the whole creation story, you know what I love? God says, it is good, it is good, it is good. And he gets to Adam and he stops. And after he's created him, and he says, man is good. He says, yeah, but there's this one thing that isn't good. And it's for man to be alone. You and I, from the very foundation of creation, God's design for us in perfection was for us not to do life alone. So don't you think in the middle of our broken and fallen condition because of sin, we need people more than ever? You and I need those kind of people in our lives. We need to seek out people who are going to help us do what God is doing in our lives. Some of you have friends and you have relationships that you know need to be cleaned out because they're not helping you grow in a relationship with God. And I'm not saying you don't tell them about Jesus and you're not friends with them. I'm saying whoever you let speak into your life indicates the direction of your life. If you show me your top five friends, I can guarantee you, I can give you a pretty good estimate of where you're going to be in the next couple years. Because the voices that you have in your life lead to the choices that you have. And so you need to seek out biblical community. And in the next couple of weeks, we're going to be launching Propel groups. That's why they're designed. That's what they're there for, to help you not do life alone. And for some of you, you say, look, I've got some friends. I'm not doing life alone. But if it's not biblical community, if you're not growing in your relationship with God, it's not helping you have the best year ever. It might help you have a good time. But I need people in my life who aren't just going to tell me I'm good at everything that I do. I need people in my life who are going to challenge the process that I've got going on. I need people in my life who are going to be willing to look at my blind spots. You and I have, if you've ever driven a car, you've got blind spots in it. Places where you can't see. And what I love about having people, having biblical community, is I have somebody in my life who can say, hey, I think that's a blind spot for you. You might want to check that out. Hey, Nick, I noticed that when you're talking to your wife, you look a little angry. Like, that might be a blind spot you need to address. Hey, Nick, I noticed that you really enjoy the smoke pit, and you might end up weighing 50 pounds heavier if you don't check that blind spot in your life. I mean, you need people in your life who are going to check you, who are going to make sure that you are on track with God. You need to seek out biblical community because they couldn't do all that God had them do by themselves. And the fourth thing is this, is that you need to reach out. You need to reach out. So we're going to clean out. We're going to clean out our nets. We're going to empty ourselves so that God can fill us up with his grace and his love and his spirit. Because if we don't clean out, then we come to God and we're full. We're going to let him fill us. We're going to push out. I don't want to be afraid of growing in a relationship with God. I want to see God do the impossible in my life. Ephesians 3:20 says that he is able to do infinitely more than we could ever ask, think, or imagine in and through the church. And the church was not a building, it's a people. That's why I love being able to do Snowpell with you. We were never more the church than we are now than when we were sitting in our living room together watching a message, because the church is not a building, it's a people. The church is not something you come to, it's something you're a part of. And so we're going to push out, we're going to grow, we're going to go into deeper waters with God, we're going to press in. And for some of you, the best place to start when you're pushing out is just to begin reading scripture, to begin saying, okay, God, look, I'm going to actually take your word and I'm going to open it. It's so simple. There's so many tools and resources that we have at our fingertips. There's the YouVersion Bible app. I started this. I'm going to read through the Bible in a whole year. I know you'd probably be shocked, but your pastor hadn't ever read through the Bible all the way. I get to about Leviticus, and I'm like, Lord, you're killing me. And so, I'm working through it. And so this year, I'm like, man, I'm gonna do this thing. I'm going to read through the whole thing this year. And as we get through it, it takes me 15 minutes a day to connect with God. And I do it at the very beginning. It starts my day off right. And from then, I get to go into my whole rest of the day knowing that because I connected with God first, He's going to bless me in the rest of it. So we're going to push out. We're going to go into deeper waters. We're going to seek out biblical community because you and I weren't created to do life alone. And then number four, we're going to reach out. This is what verse 10 says. It says, His partners, James, John, and the sons of Zebedee, were also amazed. And Jesus replied to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you'll be fishing for people." And as soon as they landed, they left everything and followed Jesus. From now on, you'll be fishing for people. I love that Jesus connects His job, His occupation, to His purpose and His destiny. He doesn't say, "I want to change everything that you do in your life." He takes what He was already passionate about, what He already loved, and He said, "I want to show you that just a little shift can take what you love to do and use it for the kingdom and can grow, and you can see more people come to know Jesus." I believe that each and every single one of us have passions and desires that God wants to use for His glory, for His purpose, and His namesake. For some of you, you're business owners. You own auto mechanic shops, you own gyms and things like that. God wants to use what you love to do for His glory, for His honor, for His namesake. You didn't come up with your passions. Isn't that cool that you and I didn't create the things that we're passionate about? Scripture says that you were knit together in your mother's womb. God handcrafted you uniquely, on purpose, for a purpose, with a purpose. And when He makes you the way He makes you, however weird that might be, He does it so that your passions, your gifts, everything that is a part of your makeup can be used to glorify and honor Him through the process. He says, "Peter, I want you to fish for people." And they followed Him. Why? Because He said so. They said, "Because you say so, God, I'll follow you. I'll follow you. I'll go wherever you want to go. I'll do whatever you want to do." One of the ways that we do that, church, is by reaching out to those who are around us using the platforms that God has already given us. For some of you, you have a platform at your work. And let me say this. Some of you are so terrified to talk about God in your workplace because you're worried about what other people might think. But Scripture says if you'd seek Him first, everything would be added unto you. Don't worry about that. God's got you covered. He says, so you can reach out using the platform that God's given you to share grace and love and truth with those around you, to tell them about Jesus. Do you know what happens every time you and I begin to reach out to those around us? Front row, you're about to get it. Scripture says that when they were fishing, they let down their nets. Do you know if you never let down your net, you can never catch all that God has for you? You've been so terrified to tell people about Jesus, and God wants to bless you in ways you never thought were possible. But if you would take your net and you would cast it out, you would see that God, if I hit you in the face, I'm so sorry. You would see that God wants to bless you in ways that you've never imagined. We got to reach out. We got to share Jesus with people. We do that through using our platforms. It could be as simple as buying a box of Krispy Kremes and leaving them in your break room. Come on. I mean, it doesn't have to be, you don't have to make it complicated. You don't have to be that guy that walks up and does fire and brimstone preaching every time, you know, "The Word of God says that if you don't know," you don't have to do that. You're weird. You should stop. Oftentimes people don't know it's the good news of the gospel because you ain't made it good news. You talk to them like they're an idiot. No, here's the good news, that even though we were sinners, Jesus chose to come and die in our place. He didn't have to. He chose to. I'm going to say it again because that's a good word. He didn't have to. He chose to. Because if you look at the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus is sitting in the garden, blood is pouring from his brow. He's sweating blood in this moment. He says, God, if there's any way that I don't have to do this, let this cup pass from me. In other words, he looks at God and he says, God, I don't want to do what you're asking me to do. I don't know if you've ever been there before. But my relationship with God can be authentic because his obedience wasn't automatic. He looks at God and he says, God, if there's any other way, but you know what? If you say so, I'll go to the cross. And he's obedient to the point of death for you and I, so that in him we could have new life, so that in him we could have the best year ever. I'm going to invite the worship team back out for just a moment. As you use your platform, one, you need to tell people about Jesus. My primary responsibility as your pastor is not to save your friends and your family, because I don't save anybody. And so if you've relied on me to carry the weight of your responsibility as a follower of Jesus, I'm not going to take it. My job is to equip you, and I'd love to do that. You can have a conversation with me, and I'll give you some tools and some resources that can help you easily share your faith. But another way that we do reach out is by inviting people to church. By inviting people to church. We use our platforms that God's given us, like social media. Social media is one of the greatest platforms that we have as people in 2017. How many of you wrote 2016 on something this week and had to scratch it out? Several things. God's given you this great platform that you can use to glorify and honor him. Don't waste it. Don't waste it. That's why we tell you, hey, if you're here, man, check in with us. We'd love for people to know you're here because we want you to use your platform. Reach out to people. Invite them. Invite them to come hang out with you on a Sunday morning. Invite them to sit with you during a worship experience. A simple invitation could change their life forever. And here's what I'll tell you. If Propel's not a place where you feel comfortable inviting friends, I would encourage you, find a church that you love and that you feel comfortable inviting people to. Because you can never do all that God's calling you to do. You can't fulfill the Great Commission. You can't operate as a follower of Jesus Christ without reaching out to other people. It doesn't work. We're going to clean out. We're going to push out. We're going to seek out. And we're going to reach out. And as we do that, church, I believe that you and I will have the best year ever. Here's what I want you to do. Will you stand to your feet for a moment? I said this at our Christmas Eve worship experience, which was incredible, by the way. If you didn't get a chance to be a part of that, I did a teaching using a nativity scene, and each figurine was pretty particular and important. If you missed it, it's online. You're going to want to watch it. It was incredible. But the whole talk was about having Jesus in the center of your life. And at the end of it, I gave you a challenge. I said, look, if you'll give us 1 year as a church, I guarantee, and you do everything, I guarantee at the end of it, your life will be changed forever. Like you come regularly. I'm not asking you to be here every week, but you make a commitment that you're going to be here. Just take a next step. If you come once a month, say, we're going to come twice a month. You get plugged into a group. You seek out biblical community. You let us help you discover your purpose so that you can make a difference. You get connected to a team. If you do everything that we ask you to after 1 year and your life isn't changed forever, I'll pack up and find another church. I believe in it that much. Because I don't think you can give God your everything and him not show up. Jeremiah says if you seek him with your whole heart, you'll find him. Not half your heart, your whole heart, you'll find him. And so for some of you, I'm going to ask you today, I'm going to ask you to give me 1 year of your life. You've owned t-shirts for longer. What's 1 year? It could be the best year ever. If you clean out, you push out, you You seek out and you reach out. As every head's bowed, every eye's closed for a moment, I know that there are some of you in here today that if I were to ask you, do you have a relationship with God? You wouldn't really know how to answer it. You come to church every now and then, or this is your first time in church, but you're not connected to Him on a personal level. What I love about God is that when He makes a way for you and I to do life with Him through Jesus, He doesn't just do it so that we could come to church. He doesn't just do it so that we could fulfill our purpose and our calling and our destiny. He does it so that we could have relationship with Him. He does it because He wanted to deposit something in your life called the Holy Spirit, who would come as the comforter, that would give you power in times of need, that would be your strength and your access to God. So if you're here this morning and you don't have a relationship with God, or maybe you strayed away and you want to come back, here's what I want to do. I want you just to say a simple prayer with me. To say, Jesus, thank you for dying in my place. Today I give you my life. I place it in your hands. I love you. I trust you. I praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, church, can we celebrate with those who made decisions for life change today?